The feud that erupted between President Trump and one of the country's top publishing houses escalated on Monday, when Henry Holt and Company, the publisher of Michael Wolff's insider account of the Trump White House, issued a defiant legal letter in response to the president's attempt to halt publication of Mr. Wolff's Fire and Fury, inside the Trump White House. Though your letter provides a basic summary of New York libel law, tellingly, it stops short of identifying a single statement in the book that is factually false or defamatory, an outside lawyer for Henry Holt wrote. Instead, the letter appears to be designed to silence legitimate criticism. This is the antithesis of an actionable libel claim. The lawyer, Elizabeth A. McNamara, who is representing both Mr. Wolff and Henry Holt, said that my clients do not intend to cease publication, no such retraction will occur, and no apology is warranted. It was the latest salvo in the battle over a book that has dominated the news cycle for days. After a lawyer working on behalf of Mr. Trump, Charles J. Harder of the Beverly Hills, California, firm Harder Meyerel and Abrams sent an 11-page cease and desist letter to the publisher last Thursday, demanding that it halt publication of Fire and Fury, the publisher responded by moving up the book's release. Holt, which had initially planned a first printing of 150,000 copies, now has received orders for more than a million books. The e-book has sold hundreds of thousands of copies and the audiobook has sold in the low six figures, according to a Holt spokeswoman. On Monday, John Sargent, the chief executive of Macmillan, Holt's parent company, sent a letter to the company's employees, arguing that as citizens we must demand that President Trump understand and abide by the First Amendment of our Constitution. In an interview with the New York Times on Monday, Mr. Sargent spoke about the response generated by Fire and Fury. This interview has been condensed and edited. What was your initial reaction when you learned of the cease and desist letter? I was in a hotel room in Phoenix, Arizona, and my initial reaction was that I was completely stunned. The person who told me said, "Are you sitting down?" And I said yes, and they said, "We have just received a cease and desist letter from the President of the United States." The reason I was stunned is that it is actually hard to conceive that a sitting President of the United States would issue a cease and desist order, because it is extraordinarily unconstitutional. From a commercial perspective, are you happy about the president's response? Yes, I think the president's response has undeniably increased the sales of the book and increased the reach of the book. I think the book is important. The book is a window into how our government under the present administration is working, so the more people who can read it, the better. And that is our concern, both culturally, as publishers, but also financially. From the letter that your outside counsel released this afternoon, it sounds like the company doesn't give much weight to Mr. Trump's lawyer's claim that the book is libelous. Can you elaborate on why it strikes the company as a weak libel case? I'd prefer not to comment on matters that go around litigation on this. Our letter from our outside lawyer speaks pretty clearly about what our thoughts are, and I'd rather let those comments stand in that case. Let's talk about your own letter, which was a powerful, pro-First Amendment statement that you sent to employees. Why did you feel it was important to send that message to people working for Macmillan? The President of the United States tried to stop the publication of this book. We were about to send a very stern letter back to the president, and people here needed to understand why this was such a big problem, why it was more important than the book itself. Free speech is one of the fundamental underpinnings of democracy, but it's also what we are about as publishers. And everybody in the company, particularly the younger people in the company, needed to understand how culturally important to the country it is that we defend the principles of the First Amendment. Why do you think Michael Wolff was particularly suited to covering this presidency? The key to the coverage was access. This is about access, and for whatever reason, which I don't know and can't speculate on, but for whatever reason, the Trump administration was comfortable having Michael in the White House, and he was in the White House all the time. News organizations and administration officials have pointed out some factual errors in the book. Does Holt plan to correct any errors in future editions? We, as a policy, always correct errors, if we find them, in reprints of the book. The issue you have here, and Michael is quite specific about it in the course of a day in the White House, there are a lot of people saying a lot of things, some of which are factual, some of which are not factual. So Michael reporting on something that is not factual can easily happen, because he's reporting on people talking about these things. Right now, we have found nothing in the book that needs correcting. I think there's a typo in it.